And today we're going to be doing the video version of the first in the series of the Rune Shamanism series. And this book is just simply called Rune Shamanism. There are three books in this series so far. One is Rune Shamanism, and then there's Rune Divination, and then there's Advanced Rune Shamanism. So those are the three in the series. And today we're going to be talking about Rune Shamanism. So while we're doing that, let's just get some introductory understandings from my perspective of what the runes are. So, assuming you know nothing about the runes, if you type in, you know, what are the runes into Google, you're going to get probably an academic version of the runes, which will tell you that the Germanic tribes borrowed alphabets from the Mediterranean region and applied it to their language and used it for rudimentary writing. And then, according to the academics, then it was used as a form of divination. So I'd like for you to first understand that that explanation, which is oftentimes taught as historical fact, is really just pure conjecture. They don't know. Academics don't know where the runes came from. So the runes are, this part is true, the runes are the alphabet of the Germanic tribes, the pre-Christian Germanic tribes. And the runes then split up, and there's different kinds of runes. There was the old, the Anglo-Saxon runes, and then there was the newer Futhark, excuse me, the younger Futhark and the elder Futhark, and anyway. But they all originated from what is known as the elder Futhark. And there was a point in history where all of the Germanic tribes used one alphabet, which we call the elder Futhark. And as it happens, the farther back you go in time, the language among the Germanic tribes was much more uniform. So that's reflected in the runes. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. So first thing I want to say is, you know, go ahead and look up the academic version of what the runes are, and then please feel free to discard that, because as I said, it's pure conjecture. There's no proof as to where the runes came from or how the Germanic tribes started using them. My contention is this. My contention is that the runes were first an oral tradition, and the Germanic tribes taught from, in my belief, most likely from father to son. A spiritual tradition of evolution. And the runes are first the sounds of the letters of speech. Now understand, the Germanic tribes in pre-Christian times, you know, especially if you go back even further than that, back into Ice Age times, they didn't separate, you know, their language from another language. There was just language. And so the runes were the sounds, the syllables, and the vowels that were used to create sound. And the idea is that the spoken word was magical. We still have this understanding today, although we don't realize it. Whenever you say, I'm going to spell out a word, the word spell comes from, you know, to create a magical spell, to chant, to, you know, do something magical. And it was understood among all people that when you made a symbol that corresponded with a sound, that that symbol had magic to it. And today we call them talismans. Sound was always understood by the ancient peoples as having innate power. And so the runes, in my belief, were understood by our tribal Germanic ancestors as being the sound vibrations that created and upheld the universe. And so the runes are these sounds that were connected to language. And by tapping into these sounds, you understood and could tap into the forces of nature, the web of weird, the web of life force energy that created, manifested, maintained, and destroyed all of the cosmos on both a seen and unseen level. And so, as you know, the runes are made up of 3/8, and it is my contention that the 3/8 correspond with the 3 levels of existence. And the 3 levels of existence are found in multiple traditions all over the world. And, you know, just pulling some out of my hat, the Christian tradition, of course I'm not Christian, but the Trinity was not taught in the Bible. This, in case you don't know that, the Trinity is not taught in the Bible. The Trinity was an understanding that was imposed upon the Bible. In fact, there were people who, you know, later on it became a big deal and were put to death and burned at the stake because they chose not to believe in the Trinity, because they were real fundamentalists and the Bible doesn't teach the Trinity. But this idea of the Trinity comes from pre-Christian tribal religion, which has an understanding that the world, the universe, and the human being is made up of 3 essential parts. You know, we hear it in just regular, you know, speech out there in the world, body, mind, and spirit. The Taoists called it heaven, earth, and man. You know, Christians, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Again, that was imposed upon it from the tribal understanding. And in the northern tradition of Europe, the Germanic tradition, you have Odin, Vili, and Ve. So these are the 3 essences of not only the universe, but of the human being. And so the runes reflect that because there are 3 8s. There are 3 sections of 8 runes. And it is my contention that each one of these sections corresponds with different levels of existence. So the first 8 corresponds with the base material existence, which would be Vili, or willpower, corresponding with the navel center, what we would call the lower self. The second 8 corresponds with Ve, or the sacred space. And this is the second level of the runes, and then we go on to the 3rd level, which is Odin. So the 3 8s correspond with the 3 levels of the human being, Odin, Vili, and Ve. So that's important. I've just shown you 2 different ways of listening the 3 8s. Now the runes have it laid out. This, again, this is according to my teaching, which I can explain. By the way, if you're not familiar with my teachings, I do tend to ramble, but I will tie everything together. And this is a traditional way of teaching, is to allow the teacher to take you down a path, because he's going to be weaving something and weaving a type of understanding and bringing things together. So if you find me going off on tangents, it's because this is I'm doing this on purpose to achieve a certain understanding within you, weaving things together. So as you can see, I just gave you 2 differentiations between the 3 realms of existence. So there's a reason why it's the term Odin, Vili, and Ve is done in that order. Odin, the 3rd eye, the upper center, the spiritual self. Vili, which is the lower self, the subconscious, the navel, and Ve, which is spirit or sacred space. It's the heart center. It's where the eternal soul resides. Now, this is done in this fashion because this is how spiritual knowledge is given to us on a moment-to-moment basis. And so this is why it's so important to be doing things like meditation, keeping these lines of communication open, because when they're flowing correctly, it'll go Odin, Vili, and Ve. your higher self, your intuitive spiritual self, down into the subconscious and the unconscious realm. And it's the subconscious realm that then takes that information from the ascended masters, from the spiritual realm, and then brings it to you, which is the soul, which lives in the middle realm. So that's why it's Odin, Vili, and Ve. That's how things are supposed to go when you live your life and you're living them in connection, and when you're not blocked up with attachments or fears or, you know, these kinds of things. That's how energy flows, Odin, Vili, and Ve. But the way that the runes are laid out in Vili, Ve, and Odin. And that's because we're going from the most dense to the least dense. We're coming from the purely physically manifested universe, and we're making our way up all the way to the purely non-physical. So halfway is where we live, you know, our souls reside here in the middle. So while I'm on that subject, let me just explain to you the shamanic understanding of the three selves. As I've already stated, this is found in multiple traditions. So this idea that there's just one self within you is not a traditional understanding. The traditional understanding from multiple shamanic traditions is that we are made up of three individual selves. And each one of these selves has a particular role. And when the human being dies, these three selves split off and go into different directions. Right now, you are living in a cooperation with two other selves. And I'll give you the theory behind that. You can choose to accept it or not. But this is from many years of research as well as personal experience. This is what I've come to, is that you have the spirit, the soul, the sawl, which is akin to the sun. In fact, the word soul means sun, and the word, you know, sawl is, you know, S-O-U-L comes from the Old English, S-A-W-U-L, sawl. And sawl meant sun. It was another word for that big, bright, orange thing in the sky. And this is akin to the self, meaning the spirit, the soul. It's the sun of the body. And it's trapped within this cage, which we call a rib cage. We call it that for a reason, because the soul is trapped within that. This is important to understand how the three selves communicate. And as I said, when the individual dies, these three selves go off in different directions. The higher self, which is connected to the ascended masters, which is connected to non-physical spiritual consciousness, that goes off into that realm. And the lower self, which is the navel center, the subconscious, the emotional patterns, the psychological patterns, the attachments, that ideally goes back and is reabsorbed into the earth, or is allowed to move up to the next level of existence, which is that of an actual soul. So the soul, which you're, the part of you that's listening to me right now, that's identifying as, you know, who you are, what your name is, this is your soul, your eternal spirit. And this goes off to one of the two realms after death. It will either go off to, in the northern tradition, off to Valhalla, which is the realm of the fearless warriors. And it doesn't mean that if you die in battle with a sword through your heart that you're going to go up to Valhalla. It means dying in battle means that you lived fearlessly and you had no fear. Now, who can say that? It's a very difficult thing to do, to live without any attachments whatsoever and to die in that state. Those people go to Valhalla. And in my belief, that's a training center to be become one of the ascended masters, which we would call the elves, the light elves in our tradition. And if the soul, like most of us, has had some fear, has some attachments, is still attached to something in life, then it goes into the underworld. And the underworld, as we know, is not necessarily a place of torture. In fact, the name hell is the Germanic word for the underworld, where it was a place of warmth and feasting and a place of recuperation. It is true that there are places in the underworld that are places of self-imposed torture, but that's what that is. Somebody dies with a lot of guilt and feels they need to be punished. Listen, the universe is more than happy to let you fulfill that if you need that. Mother Hela is not going to, you know, stop you. If you want to go punish yourself for 1,000 years, you will. And when you're done, when you're done beating yourself up, then you can recover and recuperate. You can come back. And so this is a giant training ground. Anyway, so these are the three selves. This is how information works. This is all going to be important later in rune readings. This is why I'm bringing this up. So, okay, so that's an introduction into rune shamanism. And now let's move into the actual runes themselves and how they can be used. First, let me give you the theory. The theory that I use in my practice of rune shamanism and rune divination is this. As I said, the runes are not arbitrarily created symbolic symbols created by human beings. The runes are the fundamental sounds of speech which exist eternally and independently within the cosmos. It is the vibration of these sounds that create everything. And so by chanting the runes or working with the rune sounds, you are connecting to these eternal objective forces. So I want to point out something, because there's something that's very prevalent in modern rune theory. And this, very similar to things like chaos magic and those kinds of things, which say that when you want to work with magic and you're working with symbols and talismans, you have to load the talisman with your intention. Otherwise, it's just meaningless. It doesn't have any meaning until the magician loads it. And then it will operate with that. And so in a sense, it's kind of arbitrary. Now, chaos magic is like that. If you want to create whatever symbol you want, and then you load it with your intention, it'll work. So that's a whole other aspect of magic. But runes are not magic in that sense. Runes are a shamanic science. You are tapping into the sound and spiritual vibrations in the cosmos that already exist. And so that's the first thing. You know, there are some rune teachers that say the same thing about runes, that runes are meaningless until you load it with your intention. And some will say that, you know, you're going off of the intentions of previous rune magicians. There's some truth to that. It makes some sense, but it has an underlying assumption, which are that the runes themselves have no power other than what, you know, human beings give to them. And there's this an unconscious assumption that the runes are arbitrary and that humans created them. So I'm not coming from that perspective. I'm coming from a different perspective, that the runes exist independently. And this is, you find this understanding in shamanic traditions that have an unbroken connection into their prehistory. The reason why you find this in modern Western understanding is because the Western world, Western society, completely disconnected itself from its prehistoric shamanic traditions. We're having to reconstruct our ancestral path for that reason. So this is one of the schisms, and this is one of the things that I do. Whenever I'm working with a tradition, especially, you know, we're reconstructing a tradition, and maybe we're creating new aspects that were never there before in terms of the pre-Christian northern tradition. And so it's important to understand that, you know, in other words, we're not making this stuff up. This understanding is found in all what I would consider to be legitimate shamanic traditions that really operate from power. The other problem with operating from something that is completely of your own making, if you're responsible to have to load your intention into the runes, then that sets you up. Even if that's true, just for argument's sake, let's just go ahead and say that that's true. Even if that's true, that ends up putting you in the position of doubting what it is that you're doing, what you're tapping into, because that's always going to be in the back of your mind of, well, this is just me, and so you're going to have doubt. And so that's energy going to overcome that doubt is energy that could be used in your practice, in your spiritual work. So that's the first thing. The runes exist independently, and they are the fabric of the cosmos. They vibrate and keep the cosmos alive, and they create, maintain, and destroy everything, both seen and unseen. So that's the first thing we need to know. So, having said that, that means that every time that we think about that sound, every time we chant that sound, and every time we look at the symbol of that sound that exists independently in the universe, we are tapping directly into that. So that's the theory that we're coming from in terms of rune shamanism. There are three types. There are three ways to work with the runes. The first one is what I call rune shamanism, which is what we're going to be focusing on here. Rune shamanism has mostly to do with chanting and meditating on the runic sounds and filling that energy within us and using that to transform us, transform ourselves, to clean us out, to empower us, to grant us evolution, you know, all the things that the runes do. The second way of using the runes is for divination. And this is something that we know was used. Tacitus very clearly writes about, the tribal Germanic, pre-Christian, pre-Roman Germanic tribes that they did this. Now, they didn't specifically say the runes, but it's almost assuredly a fact that it was the runes. That symbols were carved on pieces of wood, which were then thrown out on a white cloth, and then whoever was doing the divination would take them up and look up at them as though asking for the gods to give understanding. So we have a clear understanding that this was a very important practice for the Germanic people. And I think the evidence is very clear that we're talking about the rune sounds and symbols we have today. And I'm going to go ahead with that assumption, even though it's can't be completely proven through historical sources. You know, Occam's razor and logic says that's what it was. So that's my assumption. I'm going to continue with that assumption in the teaching from here on. So that's the second way. The second way is for divination, to find out, try and find out what the future is, to try and find out messages, you know, what the deities, your guides are saying, you know, tapping into other people. And we'll get into that when we talk about the second part of the series. So that's the second way. And the third way is what I refer to as advanced rune shamanism, which is a combination of the two. And advanced rune shamanism is where you use the runes for multiple purposes, not only for yourself, but also to influence what we perceive to be external reality. And this is what we call magic, but it's also used for balance. You know, the general understanding of a shaman, and I use that word in the anthropological sense, the understanding of a shaman is somebody who acts as an intermediary between the physical and the spiritual realm. And the shaman is seeking a dynamic balance. The shaman understands that life force energy is constantly moving, and that, you know, things are continuously being created and destroyed. Even though you see me here and I look relatively the same from one moment to the next, the truth is that my cells are constantly being destroyed and put together every moment. And my state of being has a lot to do with that. You know, if I'm in a state of imbalance, then I'm going to reconstruct my body, you know, like Star Trek, you know, having, imagine, you know, going into the transporter, and then having yourselves reconstructed a little bit off. Well, that's where disease comes from, and that has a lot to do with your state of being, your state of mind, your state of spiritual essence. So I kind of got off the subject there. So that's the third aspect, which is advanced rune shamanism. So let's focus on what this first installment is, which is rune shamanism. So let's go through each of the runes. Now again, here's my understanding where the runes came from. The runes came from my belief. This is my theory. You don't have to believe it. It still works whether you believe it or not. But I think this is, I believe, this is what happened. What I believe happened was that as the Indo-European tribes were making their way up into the Northern Hemisphere, the Ice Ages came in and different groups got walled in to, you know, by giant sheets of ice into, locked into various parts of the Northern Hemisphere. And the Germanic, the people who later became the Germanic tribes, was this one group of Indo-Europeans. And so over the span of 40,000 years, their ethnicity changed, and their pronunciation of the Indo-European language began to change. And so they created their own dialect, which we would call Proto-Germanic. It is my belief that it is during these formative years, these tens of thousands of years, that the Germanic peoples came up with their own individual identity. And they created, or maybe modified an existing spiritual Indo-European tradition. And that later became the runes. And this is how I believe it was taught. I believe that, as I said earlier, that these tribal Paleolithic people believed that sound was magical, that speech was magical. When you think about it, you know, I'm stringing together a bunch of different sounds, and you are getting a very complex mental and emotional picture of what I'm saying. You know, I'm able to communicate very clearly to you just by using things we call words and sentences. And so that is a magical thing to be. It really is amazing that we can do it. So they must have had this understanding, in my belief, and so they believed that words had power. You know, we have, you know, when we say cursing somebody, you know, there was a time when if you hurled an insult at somebody, there was an understanding that that had the potential to actually cause whatever it was you were cursing them with. You know, if you curse somebody with death or illness or misfortune or unhappiness, you know, that was a big deal. And you didn't do that lightly. You know, so there was this whole understanding that speech had this connection. So the sounds had this connection with a spiritual essence that was coming out of your mouth with your breath, which is your spirit, and reaching the ears of the other person and penetrating them, or speaking, you know, just into nature itself to create or destroy or do whatever. In fact, as I'm thinking about it, I can remember a long time ago, this was back when I was teaching acting. I was an actor for many years, and I was teaching acting, and, you know, it was long before I was into a lot of the stuff I'm into now. And I was trying to explain to my acting students that they had to believe in their words that way. You know, that they had to, you know, I had an acting teacher that said, you know, you have to back up every word you speak with your whole life. Now, this is a shamanic concept. This is the concept of the shamanic warrior. In fact, it was a belief of our ethnic tribal ancestors that their oath was their life. And the reason why you didn't break your oath was because you would negate your own existence. Because once it comes out of your mouth with that sound and your breath and your spirit, it becomes a living entity, and you are connected to that. And if you break that vow, you are saying to the universe, I don't deserve to live. So who does that? They must have had this understanding of sound. And so it is my belief that they were hunters at this point. They weren't necessarily warriors the way we think of warriors. They were hunters because they lived in direct contact with nature. They didn't have things like cities and countries and infrastructure. They lived in the ice ages. They were paleolithic people. So it was a day-to-day, moment-to-moment existence. And so it is my belief that the runes were a way that one hunter would teach another how to survive. And so if you're teaching your son how to survive in this amazing world they must have lived in, there were these tiny little things in this huge, crazy, powerful, magical place that we now live in, that we feel we've dominated. They didn't feel like that. So the first level of the eight runes corresponds with the first level of existence, which would have been the physical. And we would connect that with willpower. So now I'm going to walk you through each one of the runes based on this understanding. So before I get into that, let me say that I do believe that the first rune, which we use, fehu, which means cattle, I do believe that that was imposed onto the runes later. Now, I don't mean that that invalidates it. I know there are some traditions out there that, don't even use fehu and they start with urus. Absolutely not. You've got to have those eight. It means that by the time that our ancestors got to the point where they needed another rune, it meant that their society had reached a level of self-sufficiency, and now the full impact of the runes was now able to be used. So with that understanding, we'll start with that. But we first have to talk about, fehu. So let's do what fehu is. This is the symbol for fehu. And now I'm going to give you my pronunciation, how I pronounce it. Fehu. So if you want to chant fehu, fehu. When you chant out loud a rune, you want to be able to feel it vibrate in you. And it's those vibrations that will draw the power of the rune, fehu. Fehu is the Germanic pronunciation of the Indo-European word for cattle. Now there's a difference between domesticated cattle and the wild aurochs or urus, which we'll get into next. So this is the domesticated cow, which was descended from wild aurochs, or the indigenous bison of that is now extinct, of Northern Europe. They domesticated that bison and turned it into cattle, and we call that fehu. Fehu in modern times is most associated with money. And I believe that is one legitimate interpretation. I would say more so not just money, but physical resources. And here's why. The cow provided everything for these prehistoric hunter-gatherers. With a cow, you had skins that you could wear as clothes and create into shelters. Shoes, all kinds of stuff. I mean, you could do so many things with leather and hide. So that's the first thing. You've got skins. Of course, you've got meat. You can eat the meat and all the internal organs and the bone marrow and all that. You've got sinew, which you can use as thread to bind things together. You've got bones, which can be used for tools, weapons, and of course you've got milk, which, it's interesting that human beings did not develop the ability to digest milk. It took a long time, and if I'm remembering my research, I believe that that ability to digest milk started in Europe, probably with our ancestors who decided to make that part of their diet. So that's why a lot of people have problems with dairy, because we're not originally designed to digest it. You know, our body has to come up with the ability to do that. So, point being is that fehu means resources and it means cattle. And to this day, for instance, if that phone rings, you know, it automatically charges them a fee, a fehu. And fehu means payment. And so this is why it has this connection to money, because money did not exist. And Tacitus is very clear on this. The Roman historian, you know, says that the Germanic tribes did not use money. They used cattle. So if you wanted to buy something, you gave somebody a fehu, a fee. You gave them a cow. So that's why to this day, you know, when you provide a service, you charge a fee, a fehu. So fehu has a lot to do with money. But again, what does money do? Money doesn't do anything for you, especially now. Paper money, even coin money, has no value other than what we put onto it. The whole point of money is to get you the resources. When somebody gives you money, then you can go buy the food and the clothing and the computers. You can buy all the stuff with the money. So the money really doesn't exist. It's the energy of resources. It's the stuff. You know, all the stuff you see here is fehu too, because it can be used to barter and trade. So this is fehu. So this is the first one. So the first thing that the warrior learns is he learns how to take care of his physical body through the resources. And when you don't have access to physical resources, then you chant or you meditate on the sound fehu, fehu. So the F sound, the f, this sound must have represented a connection to a spiritual force that brought you physical resources. So, interesting note, while I'm here, just by chanting this sound, I can already feel myself going into an altered state of consciousness. The energy level of my body has gone up. I can feel energy coming out of my hands just from those two chants. So these are very powerful. And I recommend that you use appropriate caution with them, because you're tapping into directly into the building blocks of the universe. So this is why we chant the runes. It's going to clean you out. But just be aware of what it is you're tapping into. It's very powerful stuff. Okay, so that's fehu. That's the first. And again, the first aid has to do with the realm of vili, the realm of willpower to take care of this physical body, how to best function in the world. So the next rune that the hunter would teach to his son is the Uruj rune. The way to pronounce that Z sound, in my opinion, based on my work with the sounds, is not a Z, but a Zh sound. So the way to pronounce Uruj is Uruj, Uruj. Now you're hearing the slight flick of the tongue on the top of the mouth to get that R sound. We have hard, I don't know what you call that, the kind of R, you know, the kind of the, you know, the pirate R's that we have in America. But I believe that they had, you know, the sound, the R trilled off the top of the roof of the mouth. If you can't do that, it's not a big deal. You know, if you can, it'll be better for you. Touching the tongue to the roof of the mouth and the palate and behind the teeth and all that connects you to energy lines, meridians in the body. And this is a very powerful technique. So if you can do it, great. If not, no big deal. But this is the second rune. Uruj. Uruj. And this is a very powerful rune. And the reason why I believe this was the first rune, well, I can really feel that in my body. The reason why this rune was the first rune, in my opinion, is because before the cow was domesticated, you had the aurochs, which was running around, the bison. And this was one of the main sources of food. And this is where the tribal Germanic people learned that the aurochs was like the Walmart of, you know, Paleolithic times. Because as I said already, you know, I already explained to you, it has everything. It has, you know, it has skin, it has meat, it has bone, it has sinew, it has horns, it has all that kind of stuff. But the urus was extremely powerful. I mean, it was an, you know, we can tell just by, you know, looking at it. It was this huge bison, which we already know. Bulls are these crazy powerful beings. But when people, historical figures write about the aurochs, and Romans talk about, you know, hunting the aurochs, and they talk about how incredibly fierce this animal was. And so, so as you can see in the symbol here, it's the a bull. The horns are down. You know, it's the bison with its horns down, ready to charge at you. So it's just pure power coming straight at you. And so this is why they chanted it first, because the thing they needed most was power. They needed bravery and power and strength. And it's interesting, you know, the Germanic tribes were seen by other, especially the Mediterranean tribes, the Germanic tribes were seen as being big and strong and powerful. Probably because they chanted this rune, Rouge. So that's the second thing that a hunter needs. The hunter warrior needs power and bravery. This is important on a bunch of different levels, but the first one is, you know, you got to go out and hunt. Now, if my theory is correct, and we're talking about the runes going back all the way to Paleolithic times, then that means that hunters are going out there and putting their life on the line. You know, in Paleolithic times, even the deer had, you know, their antlers went out at something like 10 feet wide. And so with their antlers, you know, they could take somebody out very easily. Obviously, the urus could easily take out, you know, a bunch of people at once. So hunting the urus was no laughing matter. You had to be willing to put your life on the line. And the reason why you put your life on the line was so that the rest of the tribe could live and survive. And people died. There's no doubt about it in my mind. People going out there with spears and with bows and arrows, and they're going up against this immense, fierce creature that now has to defend itself. People are going to die in this process. So a warrior was brave, and this is where the Germanic understanding of bravery in battle comes from. So this is the power of Uruj. When you chant Uruj, you're going to be filled with this power. You're going to feel the power and the bravery of the bull. Obviously, it's going to give you power to reproduce. So it connects with sexual power, sexual fertility. You know, I had a student of mine, a young guy in high school. And, you know, urus obviously is connected to health, because if you're physically strong, it brings health. And he wanted some more health, so he started chanting Uruj. And chanting it just ferociously. And he ended up so sexually overwhelmed, it was driving him crazy. So you got to be careful with this rune. So it gives power, sexual power, as well as physical power and physical health and bravery. And, you know, I guess for men, it's going to release a lot of testosterone. So, you know, just understand that. So that's the second urus. Urus, for me also, from a spiritual perspective, is the power of descending spirit into physical manifestation. So, you know, just, again, we could go on and on and on about all of the things here. So that's Uruz, the second. So now the young hunter, he knows how to get his supplies, take care of himself physically. And now he knows how to take his bravery out into the world and become a hunter and provide. And he's willing to put his life on the line. And so he needs strength and bravery, raw power from the universe. Now he needs to learn how to defend himself. He's got all this power. He needs to be able to defend himself. And this comes to the next rune, which is Thurisaj. Thurisaj. Now again, you know, chant it however you can. My belief is that the TH sound isn't a th sound. It's a th sound. Thurisaj. We see this reflected in different dialects. In, you know, the TH sound is the first sound for Tunar or Thor, the god of lightning and thunder, which is directly related to this rune, which we'll get into. But in the Germanic continental, he was Donar with a D. It's not th, it's more of the tongue behind the roof of the mouth, and it's aspirated, meaning that air is coming through it. So it's a thu, thunar, thurisaz. So the thurisaz rune is a rune of protection. So he needs to protect himself, the hunter. And it's not only physical, but it's spiritual. So understand that these Paleolithic people lived in a very magical world. And everything was real, physical and non-physical, you know. If somebody had a shamanic experience or a dream where, you know, Thor materialized to them, you know, they wouldn't say, I had a dream where Thor came to me. You'd wake up from the dream reality and you go into physical reality and you say, I just talked to Thor. And nobody would question whether you dreamed or not. You know, maybe that information would come out, maybe it wouldn't. But they understood that walking in dreams and walking in this dream were the same. So you needed physical and spiritual protection. And Thurisaj is the rune of protection. It's also the rune of being able to provide your own personal boundaries for your own personality. You know, people that have, you know, bad personal boundaries are people that don't know how to keep other people from influencing them, or to, you know, they don't know how to not get into other people's business. These are all boundary issues, and it's not just on a mental or psychological, it's also on a physical and a spiritual level. So Thurisaz is a great rune for your aura, because your aura is your first and your last defense against all negativity, whether that be physical or spiritual or mental or whatever it is. So Thurisaj is the rune for that. Chanting this rune provides you a sense of identity, a sense of protection. Your aura is protected and you're able to drive away negativity. So when you chant Thurisaj, one thing you should know is that if there are people in your life who are not working for your best interest, whether they mean to or not, if their boundaries are not clear and they're not, you know, it's not a healthy scenario for you, Thurisaj will drive them away. I've experienced this numerous times where I've been chanting this rune, working with this rune, and out of nowhere, somebody in my life will just flip out, and then they'll just leave. And then as I think about it, I am aware, yeah, that person was not a very, you know, they weren't a very healing influence on me, and I just wasn't that aware of it, you know. So if you have doubts, if you're feeling guilty, there's people in your life and they're getting into your business, or you feel overwhelmed or whatever, and you're not sure whether or not you should push somebody out of your life, chant this rune. And the universe will make it very clear. Either that person's behavior will change, or your boundaries will be more clear and you'll stay out of people's business, or that person will leave your life altogether. And this is Thor, the god Thor. Thunar. He's the god of personal boundaries. The electromagnetic field, which is keeping me from going through the chair, is Thunar. Boundaries keeps us all safe and gives us our own identity. So this is Turisaj. The next rune that we're moving to is extremely powerful. And this is the rune Ansuj. Ansuj. Some sources say that Ansuj means ancestor. But this is a very powerful rune. And some refer to this rune as the God Mouth. So it has a lot to do with speech, has a lot to do with spiritual speech, it has a lot to do with communication with yourself and with the spiritual realm. So once the hunter has gone through the first three runes, now he's got his supplies, he's got his bravery and his power, he now has his own identity given to him. Now he needs to learn how to communicate with the gods. And so Ansuj is a rune that connects you directly to communication with the celestial deities. Ansuj is a rune of the Aesir, who are the celestial deities. There's the celestial and the terrestrial deities. We'll get into that. So chanting Ansuj will give you the power to connect and allow the celestial powers to flow through you, to connect with you. What's interesting also here is it's God Mouth. We talked about that speaking creates. So chanting Ansuj will give you the power to speak your world into existence, speak your intention into existence. Speaking things into existence has a very close connection with the lower self. And again, these are runes of the lower self. So Ansuj means that the warrior has to be able to magically create with his speech. He's no longer an infant who just screams mama and dada and makes da-da-da-da-da-da, just makes nonsense noise. Now he's using words in a way that actually create. Ways that communicate to other people and communicate to this matrix we live in to create, you know, magically create things. So it's a rune of empowering the subconscious. It will clear out the subconscious clutter. So chanting Ansuj is very powerful. It will open up the crown chakra. It's an incredibly powerful rune. Of course, they're all incredibly powerful in their own way. So that's Ansuj. Chant Ansuj when you want to connect to the celestial deities, when you want free communication between yourself and the gods, yourself and other people, and within the three selves within you. When you need that clarity of communication, you chant Ansuj. You chant Ansuj when you want the power to use magical speech to create in your life. Things in your life, bring your intentions into manifestation and know the difference between being connected and clear on a subconscious level and being cluttered. You'll learn that by chanting this rune. Okay, so now we move on to the fifth rune, which is Raito. Raido. So spelled R-A-I-D-H-O. Raido is literally means two things. It means ride, you know, when you ride your horse. It's a very specific understanding. You're riding your horse, meaning you're directing it, not just on it, riding it. You're directing it towards the right path. The chosen path, the path you are meant to be on. Ride. You're riding that horse. It also has to do with the word right. R-I-G-H-T, you know, righto, right, means the right one. We consider to, you know, there's right and wrong, and, you know, so this is the right path. And when this rune is a rune that will guide you to your soul's destiny. So it also is a solar rune, and the sun travels on its path, you know, and if the sun did not, you know, in the sky, of course, you know, we go around the sun, but you know what I mean. If the sun isn't traveling on its correct path, then there's going to be major problems. So the sun has to be in its right spot all the time and traveling in its right path all the time. It has to come up in the east and go down in the west and, you know, all those kinds of things. Otherwise, there's major problems. So, again, this is a rune of the soul, because Sawal and soul and the sun have to do with the path of the eternal spirit. So this gets us to that path. It also has to do with ritual. The word ritual, the root of that is rite, R-I-T-E. And ritual is very important. You have to do ritual correctly. When you do ritual correctly, what happens? You get put on your right path. And this is why we do ritual. We do ritual because the subconscious absolutely needs guidance. You know, when we're not centered in our subconscious, again, our lower self, all of these first eight have to do with the lower self. If our subconscious is not aligned and is not communicating properly, then we create all kinds of chaos and we don't even know what's right and what's wrong. And we, you know, so this helps us. And this is why we do ritual correctly. Ritual is so important. Shamanism, you light the candles and you do all that stuff. I teach a lot of that stuff in other materials. We'll get into that. But if you want to be a shaman, you have to understand ritual. And you have to understand what ritual does and why it's so important. The subconscious creates the universe, and the subconscious definitely wants to be directed, and it wants to know what the right thing to do is. And all the symbols that you use, the candles, the incense, the talismans, the directions, the time of day, all that stuff, the subconscious takes that stuff very seriously. And so that's why ritual is so important. So this is raito, raito. So chant that when you want to get on your right path. You want to learn what the right thing to do is when you want to get connected to your spiritual dharma, your orlog. That's what one of the things this rune will do. So after we've done that, the hunter gets all of his supplies, he gets his bravery and his power and his strength, he learns how to protect himself and create his own identity, then he learns how to communicate with the gods and with other people and to magically create with his words. Now he's got all this power, he's got to go on the right path, and this is Raido. Then he needs understanding. So we move into the next rune, which is Kenaj. Kenaj is a really wonderful, multifaceted rune, and I share about this, but, you know, it's interesting, you know, little kids, you learn a lot about the Proto-Indo-European language by listening to little kids. They say things intuitively that bring us back to how our language used to be spoken. And one of the things that they do is they'll say, "Mommy, can I have a cookie?" And then oftentimes mothers will correct them and say, "You mean, may I have a cookie?" But no, this child is right. He says, "Can I have a cookie?" He's using the word kenaj in its multifaceted form. Because when he asks, "Can I have a cookie?" he is asking for permission. He's asking for the ability. You know, sometimes people say, "Can I do this? Can I have that?" You'll go, "I don't know. Can you?" Meaning, do you have the ability to use it? So permission and ability and knowledge. So knowledge is important. You have to know. You have to know how to do something. I guess the best way to describe it, these three aspects, is driving a car. Do you know how to drive a car? Can you drive a car? Well, we have to get licensed, so we have to get permission. Can I drive a car? Yes. The state of California has given me a license and says that I have permission to drive a car. Do you know how to drive a car? Meaning, can you sit in a car and do you have the ability to know how to step on the gas and know how to turn and know what the signal is? You have to know all that. And then you have to have the ability. You know, can you pick that up? Do you have the strength to pick that up? So it has to do with permission, knowledge, and ability. All of these things are wrapped up in this word, kenage. So this is what's important to know about knowledge. Nowadays, we think that knowledge is a bunch of facts in your head. But those facts don't give you permission or ability. You know, this is the difference between us and our Paleolithic ancestors. Our Paleolithic ancestors, you know, they had to have the knowledge and the ability, because it was all about physically being able to make things happen. So if somebody had kenage, he had permission, knowledge, and ability. And this is what this rune gives. So self-knowledge is very important. Without self-knowledge, you will not have the ability to function in life in such a way. You won't be able to, you know, get the job, have the business, whatever it is. You won't have it. So kenage is very important. So the hunter goes through all of this, and now he needs to have this ability, the kenage, the knowledge ability to create and manifest in his life. Okay, so once the hunter warrior has gone through all of these stages and he's gotten kenage, knowledge and ability, now we move into the next one, which is gebo. Gebo is, you know, I think the symbol here for gebo, as you can see on the screen here, it's intersecting lines. And to me, it looks like a free flowing of energy moving in multiple directions. All of, you know, each of those little sticks in there are of equal length. So it's about equal exchange of energy, give and take. So once the warrior hunter has gone through all of these stages, now he has to be able to give back. He has to be able to give of his knowledge, his ability, his power, his bravery for the benefit of the tribe. So as we're moving, you know, the first part of the wheel here, as we're going through the runes, it's about self-empowerment. Then we get halfway through. You know, when we hit raito, you know, halfway through. And then it becomes about giving back to others. Knowledge is important of this. You have to have self-knowledge in order to be able to function with other people and give to people. And gebo, for me, the most clear understanding of gebo is giving freely without any agenda, without any desire for repayment. We call it generosity. You know, gebo, to give. When you give somebody a gift, you give it. It's over. It's not yours anymore. And you don't give it to get anything back. I mean, it's nice to get, you know, thank yous and all that, but that's not why we do it. If you do that, you know, people who give with the hope of getting back, they're always angry. You notice that? They're always upset. You know, I did this for so-and-so and they didn't. You know, there's a really wonderful adage that says, you know, if you're going to lend, you know, money to a friend, don't expect them to repay it. It'll destroy the friendship. You know, so if you give to a friend, you know, if you want to become a bank, they're not your friend. They're your, you know, they're your whatever, client or whatever it is. They're paying you for the privilege of you lending them money. So if you give somebody something to somebody, give it for free. Don't expect anything back. And our tribal ancestors were noted to be like this. When Tacitus talks about them, he talks profusely about it was part of the Germanic tribal mindset to be generous. If somebody showed up at your house and needed or wanted anything, you had to give it to them. And you know, to not do that was unthinkable. You know, so people needed a place to stay, they needed food, or whatever. You gave it to them. If somebody came over to your house, you know, it was expected that people could just show up and knock at your door and you were, you know, going to provide them with food. And then when you were done, they'd say, hey, let's go over to so-and-so's house. And you'd go over to that guy's house and he'd have to get out of bed and make you some food and whatever, you know. It was part of their society. Everybody gave to everybody else. And so it just wasn't, you know, if you walked into somebody's house, again, this is Roman historians make this clear. If you walked into somebody's house and you commented on, wow, look at, that's a really pretty rock. You'd say, oh, you like it? Here. You had to give it to them. But they also knew that you would give something back. You know, this was part of the whole society. Everybody gave to everybody. It was part of our dynamic. As you know, this is how our ancestors lived. And I'm sitting thinking, and it's sad now. We don't live like that. It's, you know, somebody comes knocking on your door. It's like, what do you want? You know, we just don't trust people like that. We don't give like that. It's a very different world. So this is a very important rune to learn how to give. And it's part of, you know, when you've got all this power and this knowledge now, it's your responsibility to give back so that the rest of the community can learn from it. So, you know, that's what teachers do. Teachers give back what they've learned. You know, that's part of what they do. So, Gebo, very important rune. Okay, so now we get to the last, the eighth rune in this first part of the Rune Shamanism series. We get to the rune Wunjo. Wunjo. You know, Wunjo is such a great rune. It's at the end of the first eight for a reason. It means joy. You know, it's translated as joy, but I think it has other meanings, which I'll share with you. But it means that joy is earned. You know, when we want things instantaneously, and we get it through, you know, food, sex, drugs, whatever. You know, we get it instantaneously. We're not really it's fleeting. And once it's gone, then there's a down. You know, you come down. You eat a bunch of sugar. It tastes really good, and you get a rush, and then you crash. You come down. True wunjo, true joy is earned, and there's no crash from it. So what it's saying is, if you want joy in your life, you have to go through these first seven steps. Okay? You have to go through these first seven steps, and then you get joy. And it's nothing, nobody can take it away from you. So, but you can chant this rune and you can get this feeling. I was doing it today as I was thinking about this rune, and I chanted it out loud, Wunjo, Wunjo. And I felt this calming, comfortable energy come down into my navel center. And I think there's another connection. You know, I think Wunjo is fun. Say Wunjo with a strong Germanic accent. Wunjo. Fun. It's fun. Joy is fun. Doing things that bring you joy is fun to do. Puts a smile on your face. It's fun. To win, you know, is part of that too. Winning, you know, meaning, you know, people use, yay, it just gives you joy. And it gives you this understanding that to truly win is not about competing. It's about earning through living in harmonious balance with yourself. So I'll wrap up this first state with that. When you've come to a state of dynamic balance with yourself on the level of vili, the level of the physical realm, the end result of all of that is joy. And so this is something that the warrior hunter would teach his son, you know, about the power of the runes. He'd be teaching him how to have joy in his life. On the physical level, this is how you do it. And you go through these steps. And of course, each one of these runes are so deep and so multifaceted that I'm not even barely scratching the surface here. Okay, so now we've gone through each of the runes of the first eight. And so now I want to give you some practical things that you can do. Let's go ahead and just get started about chanting the runes. Since this is rune shamanism, the main goal that we want to accomplish for ourselves in this particular installment of the teaching is we want to learn how to empower ourselves on all levels with the power of the runes. So again, you know, even though the runes are, you know, set up in three eights, and each one of the three eights corresponds with three levels of existence, the navel or vili, the third eye or Odin, and the heart center or Ve. Each one of the runes, regardless of which eight they're in, is going to vibrate on all of these levels to some extent. So that's what you want to be thinking about when you chant these runes. You want to just let the sound penetrate you on all levels and listen to your body. You're going to feel the vibrations in different parts of your body. This will give you an idea of what part of the body, which one of the three centers is being most affected by the rune in question. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to chant them out loud. There are two major ways to chant the runes. The first one is out loud, and the second one is silently. I'm going to teach the silent method on the third DVD, the third video. For now, we're just going to work with chanting the runes out loud and letting it fill our bodies and our auras. You know, when we chant runes out loud, one of the most powerfully impacted parts of us is going to be our aura. So this is why we chant things out loud. When you want to achieve something externally, you say it out loud. When you want to affect the physical body and the aura, we chant it out loud. So that's what we're going to be accomplishing here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through each one of the eight runes, and I'm going to chant each rune three times. So this, you know, go ahead and just take what I'm giving you here, practice it on your own, play around, experiment with perhaps different pronunciations. You can also look at the runes while you're doing them. You can look at the symbol and chant it. And this will affect the mind as well as the body and everything connected to it. So let's just go ahead and get started. So I'm going to do each one of the runes, chant them three times. This way we're chanting them for into each part of our body, Odin, Odin, Vili, and Ve. What I want you to do is, I want you to, you know, you can stand if you want. You can sit if you want. You can lie down if you want. What's most important is that you be comfortable. That there isn't a whole lot of physical tension. And so I'm just sitting comfortably in a chair. I'm going, and I've got my back up against the chair. I'm comfortable. I normally like to sit with my spine rather straight, but outside of that, I'm very relaxed and comfortable. So that's the thing. If you are sitting down, what's going to be important is that you let your head, your chin fall forward like you're holding a tennis ball. You know, you don't want your chin like this when you're doing chanting, because then the energy can get stuck in the back of the head. So if you are going to be sitting down, you want to at least let your head drop forward a little bit while keeping your back straight, your neck straight. This straightens out the back of the neck. That way the kundalini, the life force energy, can come up the back of the head unobstructed. Okay? So here we go. Starting with Fehu. And you can just relax and inhale. First, let's get some breathing going. So with your hands, my hands are just comfortably on my knees. I'm very relaxed. I'm going to go ahead and close my eyes. I'm going to focus on this area, which is the third eye, or the area of Odin in the physical body. And I'm just going to begin breathing long and deep. Inhaling through the nose and allowing my abdomen to expand out. Don't want to breathe from the chest, you breathe from the abdomen. Let the abdomen expand and contract. That's where it's happening. So inhaling very deeply through the nose. Exhaling. So I just took three big, long, relaxing breaths. You can do this for as long as you want until you feel relaxed and comfortable. And then we start with Fehu. Inhale. Fehu. Then when you're done chanting, inhale very deeply. Hold the breath for 3 seconds. And exhale. Okay, so that's Fehu. Fehu. I'm going to move on now to Uruj. Once again, staying relaxed, the eyes comfortably closed, neck comfortable as though we've got a tennis ball underneath the chin. Inhaling very deeply. Ooh. Inhale very deeply. Hold the breath. Allow the power of Uruz to fill your body and your aura. And release the breath. You can take time if you want between each rune, or you can move on, whichever you feel led to do. So I'm going to move on now to Thurisaj, inhaling very deeply. Inhale very deeply. Hold the breath. Allow the power of Thuri Saj to fill your body and your aura. Exhale and release. Spend just a moment meditating on the power of Thuri Saj to protect your aura, your boundaries, drive away evil and negativity. Inhale very deeply. Begin with the next rune. Inhale very deeply. Allow the power of the divine presence, the ability to communicate with the divine, let that fill your navel center all the way throughout, radiating throughout your entire body and aura. And exhale and relax. Let Ansuj sink into your being. Moving on to the next rune. Inhaling. Rai. Deeply, allowing the power of Raito to fill your body and your aura, guiding you to your highest destiny, your true path. Releasing the breath, surrendering yourself to your highest path in life. Moving on to the next rune. Inhale very deeply. Can I power of knowledge, ability, self-knowledge, divine permission, filling your entire being, granting you knowledge and accomplishment in life. Exhaling and releasing this power, feeling yourself becoming empowered with knowledge, ability, and permission. Moving on to the next rune. Inhaling very deep. Inhaling very deeply, holding the breath and allowing the power of the free interchange of energy, true generosity. As you give, it is given back to you. Exhaling and releasing this power of true selfless generosity, knowing that it comes back to us. Moving on to the last and final rune in the first eight. Inhaling very deeply. Inhaling very deeply. Holding the breath, allowing the power of joy, fulfillment, fill your body, knowing that all of the first seven runes leading up to it are also contained within this rune. Allowing the full impact of the first eight, fill your entire being. Exhaling and releasing this energy into your aura and into your life. Now spend a few moments breathing long and deep, allowing the power of the runes to fill your entire being on all levels. And now finishing your first 8 rune meditation, bringing your hands together, holding them at the heart center, sealing all of this knowledge into your middle self, your vay, power of sacred space, where your soul resides. And then what I do is I touch here from the heart center, I touch the upper center, I touch the navel back to the heart. This creates the circuit between all three of the cells so that the communication between all three of them can continue unimpeded, so that the soul will receive spiritual knowledge directly from the lower self, which has received knowledge directly from the higher self, the ascended masters. Once again, heart, third eye, navel, back to the heart. Okay, so we finished chanting each of the runes of the first 8 3 times. The idea is that by chanting these first 8 runes, we are empowering ourselves on the material level. Now, bear in mind, the material level doesn't just mean this physical flesh here, you know, because there's all kinds of things connected to manifested reality. There's physical and non-physical attributes to our manifested world. So again, the runes, all of the runes vibrate on multiple levels, very deep. But the theory behind this is that this first 8 empowers the hunter to be able to master his physical body and his physical life. So let's walk through it again. This is what happens. First thing that happens is that the hunter teaches the son how to provide for himself in terms of his physical needs with fehu. Then he needs bravery and he needs strength. He needs the power to protect himself, the power, the bravery to face down those mighty animals of the Ice Age period. In order to clothe himself, he needs the power that comes from the ability to sexually procreate, and Uruz gives him this power. Once he's done that, he moves on to Thurisage, which is the power of Thunor, the god of lightning and thunder, who's also the protector of all the human population. He is the protector of the middle yard, or Midgard, or Middle Earth. And this gives him the power to make sure that he knows what his boundaries are and make his boundaries empowered, so that nothing and nobody can take away his strength, his identity. And then the hunter teaches the son about the power to connect the god mouth, the power to connect speech to the celestial divinities, the Aesir, and to open the realms of communication between the human being and the divine. This has a strong connection with the subconscious, because it is the subconscious that gives us the power to manifest our intention. We say lots of guts, but it gives us the intention, you know, that gut feeling. That comes from a strong connection to the celestial realms, to the celestial deities. And it is with the mouth that we are able to manifest these powers. So once the hunter has taught the initiate or his son how to empower his speech and empower his communication skills with other people and with the divine, then he moves on to the power of Raito, which allows him to follow his highest destiny, to stay on the true and the right path, to follow his orlog, is origin law, the power to understand ritual and how ritual aligns him and aligns his being on all levels. This is the power of Raito. And once the initiate, the son of the hunter, learns how to follow his highest destiny, then he moves on and he must now obtain wisdom and knowledge. So he moves to Kenage. Kenage allows him the ability to understand, gives him wisdom, gives him permission, because he learns how to gain permission to accomplish things, gives him ability, knowledge, and permission so that he can, Kenage, so that he can perform and function on all of these levels in a practical way. His knowledge must be able to be used practically for his own survival and for the survival of the tribe. Once he is given that knowledge through the rune of Kenage, then he moves over into the next rune, which is Gebo. And Gebo, now that he has all of this power and he has this knowledge and this ability, now he offers his abilities to the rest of the tribe. He gives of himself selflessly to everything and everyone. And by giving himself selflessly in this way with his abilities, then the universe responds by giving energy back to him. And the exchange of energy is now achieved between everybody. Having now gone through the first seven of the runes, on the first eight, this now gives the hunter joy. And this is an earned joy. It's a joy that comes from being fulfilled on multiple levels. Wunjo comes from the root, which means joy. It means fun. It means to win. It also means desire. Comes from the same root where we get the vanir and the word Venus, wunjo. In Latin, the word Venus is venus. This is the same root. And so wunjo is the fulfillment of desires, which brings joy, meaning true desires, desires that are inherent within us. And it is part of our deepest desire to become a fully operational, a fully empowered human being on all levels. So now that the hunter initiate has been taught all of these first seven runes of the first eight, the eighth rune comes of itself, which is joy. So this is the first eight, and we're going to move on to two more DVDs after this, and we'll do the second eight and the third eight. This video is, I'm encouraging for you to use it hand in hand with the book, Rune Shamanism. I go into very, a lot of detail in that book as well. But now you've learned how to chant these runes, and I encourage you to chant this on a daily basis. Now you may find that after chanting the runes, you may feel kind of loopy. So what's important is to then meditate. There's a real simple way to ground all this energy, and that is, if you're sitting down or even if you're lying down, take your hands, and you see I'm interlocking them, my left hand into my right, and then my right hand is going to cover my left, and then these are going to go over my navel center, and then we just simply breathe long and deep. And what we're doing is we're allowing the heat of the hands to focus the energy that we have stimulated, and that energy is now being drawn into the navel center. The navel center acts like a processor. By the way, this is why Thunor wears a belt and why his strength is doubled when he wears a belt. It's a lesson teaching us that the navel center is a very important power center, and it's the power center that is able to filter and purify life force energy and send it throughout the rest of the body and the aura. So you can just stay in this position, breathing long and deep for 3 minutes or for as long as you like. you're lying down, you might fall asleep, that's perfectly fine. So, there you go. That's Rune Shamanism, the first eight. And then now once you've watched through this, you can practice this or you can move on to the next DVD. Rune Shamanism, the second eight.